أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين وحبيب إله العالمين أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد. وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين الهداة المهديين. قال الله تعالى في كتابه الكريم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، وسارعوا إلى مغفرة من ربكم وجنة عرضها السماوات والأرض. صدق الله العلي العظيم. My dear brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. A young man comes to his father one day and he tells him, "My dear father, I have finally found the woman of my dreams. I have finally found the woman that I want to marry." And he's very happy about that. He's very excited. So he tells him, "Oh father, only if you were to see her and how beautiful she is." And then he begins to explain to his father the qualities and the features of his future wife. "Oh father, only if you see how beautiful she is, her blonde, beautiful, silky hair, her blue eyes, her physique, she's so talented, she's so funny," so on and so forth. He gives him all the qualities. "Father, I want you to come and see her and to bless the idea of marrying her." So the father is very happy for his son. He tells him, "Alhamdulillah, you finally found your future wife. I'm very happy." He takes him to go to see his future daughter-in-law. As soon as the father arrives, and as soon as his eyes fall on that woman, on that girl, he is completely stunned at her beauty. He is completely amazed at how beautiful she is, and he falls in love with her. So he takes his son aside. He tells him, "Son, I don't think this is a good idea." "Why, father?" He says, "You know what? I don't think you should marry her. Because I think a woman of this beauty deserves someone with more experience, someone like your father. So I think I should marry her. Find yourself someone else." So the son, he's outraged. He says, "What? This is ridiculous. I bring you to bless the idea of marrying her. Now you want to steal her?" So a fight erupts between them. The father says, "She's mine." The son says, "No, she's mine." So they decide to go to the judge. To go to the judge and he'll end the quarrel. He'll give a verdict. They go to the judge. "What's the problem?" They tell him that we're fighting over a girl. He laughs at them. "So ridiculous. So silly." So he says, "Let's go see the girl and we'll find the solution." Now when the judge goes, when he sees the girl, he also falls in love with her. He's astonished at her beauty. "What type of human being is this?" So he says, "Okay, I've reached a conclusion. The verdict is that neither of you should marry her. I should marry her. Such a woman deserves to be the wife of the judge, not the wife of ordinary people like you." So now it's a three-way fight. The son says, "No, she's mine." The father, "She's mine." The judge, "She's mine." So now they decide to go to a higher ranking level. They go to the governor. They arrive. "What's the problem?" The same thing. He laughs at their problem. "It's so silly. Let's go see the girl." He goes to see the girl. The same thing happens. He falls in love with her. "No, she'll be my wife. She deserves to be the governor's wife. So now it's a four-way fight. Finally, they decide to go to the highest ranking official in the country. They go to the king. Let the king decide who will marry her. They go to the king. The same thing happens. He sees her and he falls in love with her as well. He says, "She should be the queen. Such a woman of that beauty deserves to be the queen of this country, of this nation." So now it's a five-way fight. The king, the governor, the judge, the father, the son, each one of them saying, "No, she's mine. I will marry her." Now in the middle of this quarrel, the girl, she comes and she sees they're fighting over her. So she says, "I have a solution for you. Wait, you don't have to fight over me. There's a way in which we can find the solution." "What is it?" they say. She says, "Let's hold a contest, a race. I run, and the five of you run after me. And whoever catches me, that person will be the lucky husband of mine." So they say, "Fine." She says, "But I have to get a head start." So she takes a head start, and then they stand in one line from the king to the son, all five of them, and they begin to run. She runs and they chase after her. While they're running, they're pushing each other. They're, you know, insulting each other. "Get out of my way, she's mine, I'm gonna kill you," whatever, this, that, they're fighting. Now in the midst of the race, while they're following this woman, all of a sudden, they fall into a pit, So a big hole. It's very deep. They want to get out, they can't. What to do now? All of a sudden, that same girl, she comes and she looks over them with a very evil smile. She looks at them with the most evil of smiles, and then she tells them, "Do you know who I am?" They say, "Who are you?" "No, tell us." She tells them, "Ana dunya. I am this materialistic world. I personify your desires. You spend your entire lives chasing after me and fighting for me. But in the end, before you could get enough of your desires of this dunya, you fall into your graves and it's finished." This, my dear brothers and sisters, was just a moral, a parable that shows that we human beings, this is how our lives are. We spend our entire lives chasing after our desires, but before we can get enough of our desires, we fall into that pit, which is our grave. And that's when we settle, only in our graves. This life is it's a race. It's a race towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, towards perfection. And it's a timed race. That's the problem. It's a timed race. Allah only gives us a certain amount of time. And what we have to do is reach the finish line before time runs out. Everyone, when they're born, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He places a timer for them. The timer goes off. And from then on, every second, every breath that we exhale and inhale is one step closer to that death, to the finish line. You see, the Imam alayhi salam, Imam Ibn al-Mu'mineen, he says, "Nafasul mar'u khutahu ila ajal." Every time I breathe, I'm one step closer to my death. And what are we all running for? The prize of this race of life is a very unique prize. It's not like any gold medal or trophy that you find in this world. Allah mentions the prize of this race of life. Allah says in the Quran, "Wasari'u ila maghfiratin min rabbikum." He says, and rush. You see, it's a race. You have no time to spare. Allah says, and rush towards what? Number one, ila maghfiratin min rabbikum. Towards the forgiveness and mercy of Allah. And number two, this is the main prize. He says, وَجَنَّةٍ عَرْضُهَا السَّمَوَاتُ وَالْأَرْضُ. The Jannah, the heaven, the paradise. That's what we're all running after. And the Quran, it speaks about the Jannah. Allah says that the width of the Jannah of heaven is equal to the width of the entire universe, or the seven skies, the seven, you know, earths, or whatever we could see in the universe. Can you imagine how huge the universe is? Just the width of the paradise of Jannah is equal to this entire universe. And as we know, Allah, He doesn't mention the length, because the length is always greater than the width, right? Usually it's greater than the width. Allah is just telling us the width is this huge. So imagine how much the length is. And what's in the Jannah? How beautiful is paradise? In one hadith, it says that, you know, one of the Imams is speaking about the characteristics and features of paradise. He says that, "I can't even explain to you what's in paradise. It's so great, it's beyond our comprehension. It's beyond our imagination." That the hadith says, "In Jannah, fihi ma la aynun ra'at, wa la udhunun sami'at, wa la khatara ala qalbi bashar." That suffices in order to understand what Jannah is. No human being has seen anything like it, or heard anything like it, nor can anyone imagine how great Jannah is. So no matter what you imagine how great Jannah is, it will still be less than the actual Jannah. This is what the fight is over. This is what the race is all about. But you find it's a very difficult race, my dear brothers and sisters, the race of life. It's very difficult. It's very competitive. And the reason behind the difficulty of this race of life is that there are two obstacles. There are two main obstacles that hinder our progress towards the finish line. I'll speak about one tonight and the second one tomorrow night. The first obstacle that makes this race of life difficult is that there are forces that are constantly trying to prevent us from reaching the finish line within the frame time, within the time frame. There are forces that want to distract us from the race. They want to stop us and prevent us from succeeding. We have a lot of enemies in this world. Obviously, without the enemies, it would be easy to finish the race. But when you have enemies in the middle of the race that you have to overcome, it's going to become a very difficult race. But there is one enemy that we have amongst the many enemies that's greater than all the other enemies. There's one enemy that unites all the other enemies against us. There's one enemy that's the root of every crime and sin in this world. And I'm not speaking about the devil. If you think I'm speaking about the shaitan, the iblis, no. Because the shaitan, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about him in the Quran, he says, إِنَّ كَيْدَ الشَّيْطَانِ كَانَ ضَعِيفًا. He says that the tools and the mechanisms of the devil, they're weak. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says that the devil doesn't even pose a threat to you. He's very weak. So this that we're speaking about is more powerful than the devil, this enemy. And in fact, you know, in the month of Ramadan, there's a hadith from the Prophet that says the devils are all tied up. There's no devils that are trying to fool me. But still, people sin during the month of Ramadan, right? Why? That shows that there is another enemy. There is another distraction, another force that's trying to pull me away from the race. That's trying to distract me. What is it? The Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says in one hadith, "A'da aduwik." Your worst enemy is whom? He doesn't say shaitan, the devil. He says, "A'da aduwik, nafsuka allati bayna janbayk." Your soul, your spirit that lies within you, this is your number one enemy. But why? For three reasons, my dear brothers and sisters. Number one, you find that the nafs, my soul, is the closest thing to me. And because of this proximity, it takes advantage of my weak spots. Because it's so close, it knows my weak spots, and it will take advantage of my weak spots. Imagine if you had an enemy, and this was your number one enemy in the world. This person vowed to destroy you. All he wants to do is kill you and destroy you. Imagine if this enemy was in China. You'd feel kind of safe because you know he's very far. Imagine if that enemy of yours, he took a plane and he came to the US. He's one step closer. Wouldn't that cause a little fear for you? If he's your number one enemy, that he has vowed to destroy you? Imagine if he came to your state, Michigan. This would cause greater fear. Imagine if he came to this city. Imagine while I'm speaking, he came into this lecture hall. You're going to start sweating. Imagine if he came and he sat right next to you. I think you're going to have a hard time breathing if that happens. This is your number one. Imagine if that enemy is sitting right beside you, right inside you, like a nafs. Because the nafs is so close to us, it's right in us. Takes advantage of our weak spot. So this is number one. Number two, you find that the nafs, the ulama of the akhlaq, they always label it as being a wild beast. The egoistic desires that I have within me, they're like wild beasts. And a wild beast never stops hunting for its predators, right? It never gets full. It will always want more. This is how the nafs is. Will the nafs ever get enough? You see, the hadith says, لا يملأ عين ابن آدم إلا التراب. The only thing that will satisfy me, and now you know I'll say it's enough. The only time I'm gonna settle and not chase after my desires is when they lay me in my grave. That's the only time I'm gonna settle, or else I'm gonna chase after my desires. They say in the hadith that this world, the desires, they're like salt water. You've heard the hadith. The more you drink, the more you want. You'll never get enough of your desires. So this is number two. The nafs never gets tired. So that's why it's so dangerous. And number three, you find that the nafs, the soul, it uses every method at its disposal in order to get what it wants. You see, the nafs has no red limits, you know, red lines. It has no limits. It has no boundaries. It will go to the full extent in order to get what it wants. You see, the nafs, every time it comes from a different angle. If I'm young, the nafs will, you know, will fool me, and it will come from the desires of the opposite gender. When I'm a little older and that's not too dangerous for me, and I'm not too tempted by that, it'll come through wealth. And it will tempt me through wealth. Don't chase after money. Don't chase after, you know, don't continue in the path of Allah in the race. Chase after money. If I'm a little older, it's power. Every time it's a different thing. It will use every tool possible. The nafs justifies for me. It manipulates, it beautifies sins. You see, the problem is that the nafs, what it does is when we commit sins, sins are filthy. What does it do? It covers up the filth and it portrays sins in a beautiful way. This is how some of us see sins so beautifully. We don't see the filth of sins, and that's why we enjoy committing sins, some of us. You see, if I begin on committing too much sins, what does the nafs tell me? You're still young. You have a long life ahead of you. Do tawbah when you're old. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rahim, He's merciful. You know, just like Umar ibn Sa'd. And he said, I'll kill Imam Hussein. And 2 years after that, I'll do tawbah. So it tells you that, you know what? Allah is merciful. This is all the justifications of the nafs so that you chase after your desires. If I find money, I know it's not mine. I know I'm not supposed to take it, but the nafs justifies. What does it tell me? Finders keepers, losers weepers, you know? And anything that I do that's bad, it will justify. It's his fault. He started it. I have to support my... So on and so forth. The justifications of the nafs will never finish. Even those dictators you find, they also justify for themselves. For example, Saddam, when they captured him, why did you kill Fulan? Why did you kill this? Why did you kill millions of people? He had a justification, an excuse. And you know, he was serious about it. He wasn't just trying to, you know, get out of punishment. He had an excuse for every single crime that he had done. This is the nafs. It wants to justify for us. And you find when the nafs tells me to do something, it doesn't ask politely. It gives a command. Do this right now. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says this in the Quran. He says, وَإِنْ النَّفْسَ الْأَمَّارَةِ He speaks about النَّفْسَ الْأَمَّارَةِ بِالسُّوءِ وَإِنَّ النَّفْسَ لَأَمَّارَةٌ بِالسُّوءِ إِلَّا مَا رَحِمَ رَبِّي The nafs, it gives orders. أَمَّارَةِ بِالسُّوءِ It commands me to do this and that. It's not going to be polite with me. Because if it's a little weak with me, then maybe I won't listen to it. It comes and it gives orders, and it gives orders, and it gives orders until it turns the human being into an animal, just chasing after his desires, not knowing what to do in this life, not having a goal in this world. What's my goal? Where am I going to? Do I have a purpose other than chasing desires? Some people, unfortunately, not. Their goal is just chasing after their desires. The nafs sometimes, it's so powerful, and it takes me so low that it completely destroys my sense of morality. All I care about is myself. You know, subhanAllah, the level of the greed that the nafs can take me, and selfishness and wickedness is unbelievable. You've all heard the story of the man that beheaded the head of Imam al-Hussein, that decapitated the head of Imam al-Hussein. They say that he took, either it was Khawalla or Khawalli, or a man by the name of Sinan. He took the head of Imam al-Hussein to Ibn Ziyad. Why? Because he wanted a reward for the head of Imam al-Hussein. They say that he went to Ibn Ziyad, he gave him the head of Imam al-Hussein, and he recited a poem in Arabic. What did he say? He said, قَتَلْتُ خَيْرَ النَّاسِ He said, إِمْلَأْ رِكَابِي فِضَّةً أَوْ ذَهَبًا قَتَلْتُ خَيْرَ النَّاسِ أُمًّا وَأَبًا He tells him, take this head. This is the head of the best of the creations of Allah. His mother is the best of the creations and his father is the best. Yet I killed him and I want you to reward me and fill my pockets with gold and silver. So he's admitting that he killed the best human being, yet he wants a reward for it. Can you imagine the selfishness? Just for a few dinars, dirhams, he's willing to kill the best man in the universe that Allah created, and he's admitting that just because he wants to feed his beast. He wants to feed this nafs so that I can own a few of the ruins of this world. I'm willing to do anything for that. And just look at the rulers, you know, the rulers, especially in the Middle East. You know, when the ruler is in power, you don't hear about all the scandals and all the oppression. It's when he dies or it's when he's ousted out of power. For example, look at Hosni Mubarak. How much money did they find? $70-80 billion. When you look at the economy of Egypt, the economy of Egypt is anywhere between $500 to $600 billion. So one man, he's equal to 1/7 or 1/8 of the entire economy of his country. Isn't this a Fir'aun? You know, we speak about Fir'aun, alayhi salih mulku Misr, when he used to own all of Misr. When we speak about Fir'aun 3,000 years ago, that was an archaic Fir'aun, the old Fir'aun. Now we have a new Fir'aun. He wears a suit, and you know, he looks very nice, smooth. But if you look at him closely, you'll see he's a Fir'aun. 1/8 of the entire economy of Egypt, 80 million people, is owned by one man. Look at the selfishness. And he was 84 years old. What does he want to do with this money? Look at, for example, in Saudi Arabia. When the crown prince died before Naif, Sultan, The estimates of his sum was unbelievable. That in CNN, I read this, it said that Sultan's net worth when he died was $270 billion. That's unbelievable, my dear brother. I think the entire economy of Saudi Arabia, the 20, 25 million people, don't spend that much in 10 years, in 20 years, in 50 years. One man has that. And let alone the king. Let the king die, and we'll see. We'll hear about how much he has, and all the other members. So we see how selfish the human being can get. All of this he wants just to feed his beast. Just that, you know what? Just so I could be satisfied. And the human being will never be satisfied. Like I said, the hadith says only when it's only when we're placed in the grave that's when we settle. It turns us into animals chasing after our desires. And thus you see Imam Ali alayhi salam, he's quoted in one hadith saying, it's a very beautiful hadith, he says, "Maydanukumul awwal anfusukum." He says, the first round and the most difficult battle you'll have in this world is with yourself. He says, "Fa'in qadartum alayha, fa'antum ala ghayriha aqdar. Wa'in ajaztum anha, fa'antum an ghayriha a'jaz." He says that the first round is with your nafs. If you are able to defeat this nafs and not take orders from it, then you could defeat any other enemy. Because every other enemy is weaker than the nafs. But if you failed in front of the nafs, don't think that you could defeat all the other external enemies. So the nafs, this is what it does with us. So does that mean that's it, we're doomed because we all have a nafs and we're going to chase after our desires like animals? Is that it? There's no way out? No, obviously. Because you see, the same nafs that turns me into an animal, that turns me into a dictator like the ones we mentioned, the same nafs, I can use it and escalate and reach the levels of someone like Salman al-Farisi. You see, Salman al-Farisi, he reached that state through his nafs. The companions of the Prophet and the Imams, they reached the levels they did through the nafs. The ulama that we have, they reach those levels through the nafs. But in order to do that, in order to reach that level, which the Quran calls al-nafsu al-mutma'inna, ya ayyatuha al-nafsu al-mutma'inna, in order to reach that level, which is the settled nafs. You know, we said we're always chasing after our desires, we don't settle until the grave. There are some people, they settle before the grave. They have al-nafsu al-mutma'inna, the settled nafs. But in order for me to reach that state, I have to know how to fight my enemy. I have to know how to react when my enemy, which is my nafs, strikes. Because you see, in any war, you'll find one of the most important things for the army is to have intelligence. Why? So that they could, you know, increase their knowledge about their enemy's weapons, so they know how to counter-attack, right? I have to know how many troops they have, what kind of weapons they have, what's their strong point, what's their weak spot, so that if they attack, I know how to defend myself. So with the nafs, I have to know how it attacks me, so that I know how to strike back. I know how to shield myself. And that's why when it comes to the nafs, we said the nafs is a beast, right? How do you fight a beast? You tame it. How do you tame the beast? By feeding it? Never. If you just keep on feeding the beast and whatever my desires tell me, I just chase after and accept, I'm just going to make the beast bigger and bigger and stronger. You tame a beast by what? By resisting and by starving it. You let it starve, you beat it, you whip it, so that you let it know who's boss. So anytime when my nafs attacks al-ammara bisu, it gives me a command, go do this haram, go chase after this desire. How do I react? I react, the seventh imam, he says in one hadith, the best way that you defend yourselves with the nafs is through jihadun nafs. You know, we hear the word jihad so much in this country, and it's taken out of context and people don't understand what it is. But amongst the greatest forms of jihad, which is fighting, is jihadun nafs. You fight your nafs back. And how do you do that? You tame the beast within through resistance. So anytime it tells me do this, I resist. I say no. And through this way, I teach my nafs, my soul, self-discipline. That don't think anytime you want something, I'm just going to accept. Don't think that I'm a servant to you. You have to control the nafs. Many people, you find the nafs controls them. Their desires control them. And that's why they'll go to the fullest extent just to feed their desires. So I fight back by telling the nafs, look, I'm the boss. And I'll only follow you if there is good in it for me, for my dunya or akhirah. But if I'm just going to follow you just because I want to feed you, that's not going to happen. You tame the beast, you let it know who's the boss. And that's why you find one day the companions of the Prophet, they had went to jihad, they had fought the kuffar. When they came back, the Prophet told them, you know, good job on the jihad, but this was al-jihadul asghar. And you have in front of you al-jihadul akbar. This was the small jihad, the easy jihad. You have the harder jihad in front of you. So they told him, what do you mean the easy jihad? We went and we fought for our lives with the sword. What could be, you know, more difficult than this? He told them, jihadun nafs. Jihadun nafs is the most important type of jihad. And this is the difficult jihad. That when I say no to the nafs, when my desires, my ego tells me do this, just so I feed my ego, I say no. I say no, I tame it. I let it know who's boss. I let it know that there are limits. And I'm only going to follow you and feed you through certain channels and certain ways. That's the only time that I can have control over my nafs. And you know, the month of Ramadan is all about this. The month of Ramadan, what is it about? Why do we fast? Some people, they don't know why they fast. The Imam Ali says, كَمْ مِنْ صَائِمٍ لَيْسَ لَهُ مِنْ صِيَامِهِ إِلَّا الْجُعْ وَالظَّمَنِ. So many people fast. All they get from their fasting is starvation. They just didn't eat and didn't drink. Congratulations. Is that a goal? That I starve myself? And then what? I should use starvation, not eating, not drinking, to reach to a higher, more important goal. And Allah mentions it in the Holy Quran. He says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ. Fasting has been prescribed upon you, just like the people before you. Why? What's the goal? What's the wisdom behind ordaining fasting? Allah says, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. So that you may achieve taqwa. What is taqwa? Taqwa means that I control my nafs. That when my nafs says, chase after that desire, I know it's haram, I say no. This is taqwa, to say no to my desires. And how do we achieve taqwa through fasting? That I tell my nafs, look, for 30 days, you can't eat, you can't drink, and you can't do some other things, just to please Allah. So you're disciplining the nafs. Don't think that just because I'm hungry right now, I could eat. No, I can't eat until Maghrib. This is a discipline. This teaches me self-restraint. So if I could say no to water, which is the most necessary thing for Allah, I will say no to all the other desires much more easily, right? If water, which is so difficult, for 14, 15, 17 hours, I said no to it. Why? Even though there's so much water in front of me. Just to please Allah, then obviously it will be much easier for me to say no to the other desires. So it teaches us self-restraint. And finally, my dear brothers and sisters, one good way, you know, it's difficult to do jihad al-nafs and to say no. Some people, they say that when I get the temptation, when I get the urge to do this sin or to chase after that desire, I just can't. It's just too powerful. One good way and method that Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam teach us in controlling our desires is what it's called muraqabatu al-nafs wa muhasabatu al-nafs. I have to monitor myself every day and I have to hold myself accountable every day. You see, if you have a business and you have employers, if you don't supervise, they're going to take advantage. They might steal, they might, you know, slack off, they won't work. So how do you make sure that they do a good job? You monitor them, right? You put cameras, you check on them every few minutes, every few hours, to make sure that they're doing their job. With the nafs, this is exactly what we have to do. We have to monitor it. You have to let it know that it's not free to do what it wants. It has a job. It has a duty. So you monitor the nafs. And how do you do it? Every night. The hadith says that every night before we sleep, we take 5 minutes of our time. And we begin to remember what we did for that day. Anything good that I did, I encourage myself. I say, Alhamdulillah. Thank you, Allah, for giving me the tawfiq to doing this good. And inshallah, I will do it again. And if I did anything bad, I rebuke myself. I say, I did the wrong thing. This is the last time. Allah, I promise you, today I backbited, I cheated, I lied, I did this haram, I listened to music. But tomorrow, inshallah, I won't do it. So you monitor yourself every night. Because if you forget, you're going to get carried away with all the sins. So every night before I sleep, the Imam says, لَيْسَ مِنَّا مَنْ لَمْ يُحَاسِبْ نَفْسَهُ فِي كُلْ يَوْمٍ. You have to hold yourself accountable every day. Hold a trial. I speak to myself, oh, Ahmed ibn Hassan, for example. Today you did 10 sins. Be careful. Tomorrow, if I did more than 10 sins, if it wasn't 9 sins or less, I will prevent myself from something. I won't drink soda for a week. I won't eat candy for a week. I won't do this or that. So hold yourself accountable before Allah holds you accountable in the grave, because then it's too late. I won't have a chance to fix my problems, my sins. That's it. The Quran says when someone is laid in his grave, what does he say? رَبِّ ارْجِعُونِي لَعَلِّي أَعْمَلُ صَالِحًا فِي مَا تَرَكْتُ. Give me just one opportunity. Take me back to the world so I can do a few more good deeds and repent. Allah says, كَلَّا. No way. إِنَّهَا كَلِمَةٌ هُوَ قَالَ. It's just a word, he says. And even if I take him back, he won't. So this is the best way in order that we keep our actions in check. حَاسِبُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ قَبْلَ أَن تُحَاسِبُوا. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the tawfiq that we achieve taqwa during the month of Ramadan. وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله على محمد وآله الطاهرين.